Simon & Schuster Audio presents Lost in Paris, a novel by Elizabeth Thompson. Read by Emily Tremaine and Imogen Church.
August 1929, Paris, France. Dear Diary, in the twilight between sleep and wakefulness, the moment before my lashes fluttered open, I feared it was all a dream, that I would open my eyes and find myself back in the flat en Rue de l'Ombre. But now that I'm lying atop smooth cotton linens, sunlight streaming through the shears that cover the tall casement windows, I'm sure it's real. I'm in the apartment. Remnants of my birthday celebration litter the marble-top nightstand, leftover cake, the opened bottle of champagne, one empty flute, another half full. The note on the pillow next to mine reads, "Good morning, my love. You looked so beautiful sleeping I hated to wake you. I will see you this evening." I feel like a queen in this four-poster bed with the fluffy duvet covering my naked body. It is one of those rare instances in life when everything seems good and right and, dare I say, perfect. I want to live in this moment forever. For the first time since moving to Paris, I'm finally in the position to write and tell my parents I am doing well.
One. December 31st, 2018, 3 o'clock p.m., Bath, England. Clad in obstinate, headstrong girl t-shirts, the Fitzwillings laugh and whisper, interrupting my spiel about Sally Lunn's house. Again. Since I haven't said anything particularly scandalous or funny, I pause, giving the six American women, who are part of a Cleveland-based book club, the opportunity to get it out of their collective system before I wrap up my talk. We're down to the final 2 hours of my six-day ultimate Jane Austen tour. I get it. We've digested a whole lot of Jane. We've had our fill of cornices with dentils, and symmetrical fenestration, and Jane Austen slept here, and ate that, and promenaded there. I make a living leading people to worship at the altar of Austen. But frankly, today I'm over her too. In approximately 1 hour and 58 minutes, I will leave my charges to take to the waters at the Thermae Bath Spa. The moment the handoff is complete, I will be on vacation. For one glorious week, I will binge on takeout curry and back-to-back episodes of Love Island while lounging in my jammies and feeling smugly superior to the idiots making fools of themselves on national television. But I digress. The Fitzwillings, as they call themselves, are still yammering, and I'm trying not to lose my shit. I'm weighing my words because I really hate confrontation. When Jerry Sanders, a middle-aged high school English teacher from Wisconsin, says in his teacher voice, "Ladies, is there something you'd like to share with the rest of the group?" Jerry and the Fitzwillings have been sparring the entire trip. Never mind his bad habit of interjecting into my spiels factoids that are not always correct. He loves to call out everyone who even looks as if they're contemplating talking over me. "No, we're good, Jerry," says Lucy Fitzwilling. "Thanks, though." Jerry bares his teeth at her. It's been happening all week. The Fitzwillings get excited about something and start talking. Jerry calls them out. They stop for a while. Then the cycle repeats. As I was saying, Sally Lunn's house is considered the oldest house in Bath, dating back to 1482, although Sally didn't live here until the late 1600s. It's a good example of medieval-style architecture. Notice the small stones on the facade and how the windows appear undersized when compared to the elegant building behind us? As I pause to let everyone turn around and have a look, my smartwatch buzzes with a call. I glance at my wrist, even though I can't talk now. It's my mother. Marla and I have a complicated relationship. Other than an awkward 5-minute call on Christmas Day, which I initiated, it's been several months since we've spoken. Since I flew back to Orlando for my grandmother's funeral at the end of summer. In addition to wishing her a Merry Christmas, I called for an update on how things were proceeding with the sale of Graham's house, which Marla and I jointly inherited, and she offered to stage and list. As of last week, she was still sorting through Graham's possessions and grumbling about the clutter she needed to eliminate before we could even think of putting the house on the market. I didn't feel too bad for her, because as compensation for preparing the house, we agreed that she could keep any of the clutter she wanted or pocket the proceeds of anything she sells. She lives in Orlando. I live in London. That's the only way it was going to work. The cold weaves its way through the fabric of my red wool coat. I tighten my scarf and shove my hands into my pockets. I'll call her when I get back to London. Or tomorrow. Maybe. Jane Austen frequented Sally Lunn's bakery, which is still famous for its large brioche buns. I hope you're hungry, because we'll sample them when we have our tea. In the meantime, you might be interested to know Jane mentioned Sally Lunn's baked goods in a letter to her sister, Cassandra, in 1801. She said, "Though, to be sure, the keep of two will be more than of one, I will endeavor to make the difference less by disordering my stomach with Bath buns." Two of the Fitzwillings are whispering again. They're eyeballing Jerry. I talk louder. Based on that quote, we can see that Jane was well acquainted with Sally Lunn's buns. A titter ripples through the group. I am, of course, referring to brioche. More laughter. It's been said that our Jane would often keep a stash of Sally's bakes in her room to supplement the scanty meals served by her aunt Lee Perot, whom Jane and Cassandra visited in Bath. The ladies are laughing less subtly now, hardly containing their whispers, and Jerry's gaze remains trained on them with sniper-like focus. It's been a long week. The tour started in London and stretched up to Chatsworth House, famously the location of Darcy's Pemberley in the 2005 Pride and Prejudice movie. We gave equal time to Lyme Park in Cheshire, the 1995 Pemberley. We've made all the relevant stops along the way as we circled back through Bath on day 6. The women are oblivious to Jerry's irritation until he says, "Come on, out with it, ladies. Let us all in on the joke. Tell us what's so funny." They fall silent, but Jerry is having none of it. "Really," he says, "we want to know what is so damn hilarious that you keep interrupting Hannah." "Jerry, it's fine," I say. "I think we've all had enough architecture. Let's go have tea. The reservations are under heart-to-heart tours. I'm sure they won't mind if we're a little early." I hope. I herd the group toward the restaurant in a desperate attempt to defuse the situation. It works. We step inside and I give the information to the hostess, who, by the grace of God, has our tables ready. I let the others go first, and that's when I see him. He's sitting at a table all alone, his head bowed over a folio as he writes. A navy peacoat and a tartan scarf are draped over the empty chair at the table. He's wearing a black button-down, dark skinny jeans, and boots. His vibe is rock and roll, or some other old soul creative cool, but the intense way he furrows his brow as he writes makes me think of Mr. Darcy himself. I wonder if the Fitzwillings have noticed him. My watch buzzes another alert, and it makes me jump. He must see the movement out of the corner of his eye because he looks up and catches me staring at him. There's a flash of recognition on his face and he squints at me. He looks familiar, vaguely. Do I know you? If not, I want to know you. I scroll through the files in my head. Famous people? No. People I know in Bath? Uh-uh. Other business acquaintances not from Bath? Not that I can remember. Someone from university? No. Guys my roommates have dated or tried to fix me up with? Hardly. People from London? No.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.